Welcome to the online classes, Environmental Pollution Part 3. Today's topic for discussion is ozone.
Means a molecular oxygen combines with a nascent oxygen in presence of UV radiation, it gets converted itself into the ozone. So a molecular oxygen combining with a elemental oxygen in the presence of UV radiation is called as ozone. So that's how the ozone is formed in the stratosphere. This ozone is available in two different places. One is in the troposphere, other one is in the stratosphere. So the ozone, it is a highly reactive gas composed of three oxygen atoms. And it is naturally formed as well as it is formed by the man-made activities too. So the ozone, it is present in the stratosphere, that is the lower atmosphere, is acting as a protective blanket. The same ozone, it is formed by the reactions of emissions of the vehicles and highly volatile organic compounds present. So these two combine to form a ozone in the troposphere. In the troposphere, it is called as a pollutant because it is a greenhouse gas. So ozone present in the upper atmosphere, that is lower stratosphere, it is acting as a protective blanket, protecting us from the dangerous UVA, B, C radiations. The same ozone, when it is formed by the reaction between these two, NOx and VOC, that is highly volatile organic compound, and nitrogen oxide, in the presence of sunlight, it will form a ozone. It is called as a pollutant and it is a secondary air pollutant. Why it is a secondary air pollutant means, so there are certain primary pollutants already present. Like oxides of nitrogen, it is a primary air pollutant, and volatile organic compound, that is a hydrocarbon, it is a primary air pollutant. These two primary air pollutants reacting together in presence of a sunlight to form a secondary air pollutant, ozone. So one thing we should understand, so this stratosphere is present above 20 to 30 kilometers above the Earth's surface. And in the stratosphere, just beginning of the stratosphere, there is a formation of the ozone by the previous reaction which I have explained. You can see here, this is how the ozone is formed in the stratosphere. That means ozone in the stratosphere, it is a product of UV radiation and dioxygen. With the help of the UV radiation, it is formed. So in two different ways, the ozone is formed at two different places. If it is present in the troposphere, it is called as a pollutant. If it is present in the stratosphere, it is called as a protective blanket. So the thickness of this ozone, the thickness of the ozone is measured in a unit called as a Dobson unit or millimeter. Generally, the thickness of the ozone must be, the thickness of the ozone must be about 3 to 5 millimeter, or it is 300 to 500 Dobson unit. Normally, the thickness of the ozone, it is measured in terms of the Dobson unit, D-O-B-S-O-N, Dobson unit, or it is measured in terms of the millimeter, 3 to 5 millimeter. This is the general thickness of the ozone. And what is the role played by these ozone means? So this is the troposphere and this is the stratosphere. In between these two, you have a thick blanket. So that is protecting us. So about 10 to 50 kilometer thickness, we can have this ozone. And the thickness of this ozone, normally it is measured in terms of the Dobson unit or a millimeter. So it is protecting the life or biota of the Earth's surface. This is a picture of the Earth. So, biota of the Earth's surface is protected from the dangerous UVA, UVB radiations By this ozone layer, it is acting as a blanket. It shields all these dangerous radiation. As a result, the life on the surface of the earth is safe. So that is the role played by the ozone present in the stratosphere. So previous slide I told how it is formed means C2 molecule of oxygen combining with elemental oxygen to give a ozone. It is a 3 atoms of oxygen molecule. But because of some of the activities, so this ozone layer is becoming thin day by day because of the anthropogenic activities or the man-made activities. So the thickness of this ozone is decreasing day by day. So that is called as the destruction of the ozone layer. Let me repeat. So here, due to the man-made activities on the troposphere or anthropogenic activities on the troposphere leads to destruction of these ozone molecules in the stratosphere. We understood that as long as the ozone is about 300 to 500 Dobson unit, there is no harm to the life of the earth's surface. If it is getting destructed, so what will happen? That we will see later how it is getting decreasing, the thickness of the ozone is decreasing. What is the cause? We will see now. So that is called as destruction or depletion of the ozone layer. The main reason for this depletion of the ozone layer is the chlorofluorocarbons, halones, hydrochlorofluorocarbons. So all these are used in a variety of places like air conditioning system. We are using this CFC and HCFC, that is hydrochlorofluorocarbons, are used in an air conditioning system, and it is also used in aerosols, refrigerators, etc. Even some of the solvents are being used in blowing technique to blow the foams. Solvents are used in some of the pesticides, methyl bromides are used, and in the vehicles, leaded petrol, if you are using, the leaded petrol will contain the dibromoethane or dichloroethane. After combustion of the fuel, those also entering. So like this, all these substances, once it reaches the stratosphere, it will break our ozone molecule, break down the ozone molecule into a molecular oxygen. No more it is ozone. This breaking down or depleting is called as depletion of the ozone layer. The main cause for this, how exactly it is happening means, so it is all because of the man-made activities. So what are the man-made activities means? It is nothing but the CFCs which are used in refrigerators, CFCs which are used in the air conditioning system, CFCs or HCFCs used in the solvents which are used to blow the foams in making the furniture for home. All these, even in the pharmaceutical industry, the solvents are being used, and methyl bromides from the pesticides, even the leaded petrol, dichloroethane and dibromoethane are used. All these are held responsible for the depletion of the ozone layer. Now, coming to the mechanism, this is a very important question. So, explain the mechanism of depletion of ozone layer in the stratosphere. This is the reaction. See, what is this CFC, chlorofluorocarbon, means one small example we have taken here, dichloro dichloro dichlorocarbon. That means all the four hydrogens of the carbon is replaced by the fluorine atoms and chlorine atoms. It is read as dichloro dichlorocarbon. So now when these air conditioning system, aerosols, refrigerators are entering to the upper atmosphere, it break down to give a free radical, chloride free radical, and another free radical, that F2CCl2. So it will give the two free radical. This chloride free radical further it will attack the molecular ozone in the stratosphere. It breaks down this ozone molecule to release the oxygen gas, and elemental oxygen will bind with the chloride. Chloride is a highly energetic species. It is called as a free radical. It has a sufficient energy to break this ozone molecule to form a molecular oxygen, and it will become ClO dot. So this ClO dot further combines with the elemental oxygen to give you Cl dot and molecular oxygen. So like this, the reaction will continue if there is a single chloride radical found in the stratosphere. It can break down 1 lakh ozone molecule. One chloride radical, it is a chain reaction. One chloride radical can break down 1 lakh ozone molecules. So this is a chain reaction. So imagine if there are 100 number of such chloride radical. So 1 lakh into 100, that many number of ozone molecules will get depleted, gets converted into the molecular oxygen. That leads to the thinning of the ozone layer in the stratosphere. The thickness of the ozone layer in the stratosphere decreases. Due to this, the dangerous UVA, the dangerous UVB easily reaches the Earth's surface, and it will affect the life of the Earth's surface. So that means it is acting as a protective blanket and protecting the life of the Earth. Now, due to this thinning, or becoming a thin means, so it is reaching the Earth's surface. These dangerous radiations from the sun easily reaching the Earth's surface and damaging the life of the Earth. Now, if the thickness of this ozone is becoming just 100 to 150 means, that is called as a ozone hole. So that means if the thickness of the ozone in the stratosphere is decreasing due to this chloride free radical, bromide free radical, so, and if it is becoming just 100 to 150 dpsu unit, that means 1.0 to 1.5 millimeter, that is called as a ozone hole. So for the first time in the year 1980, so the first time the ozone hole was noticed by NASA, and it is called as a Antarctic. It is called as a Antarctic spring. Why it is called as a Antarctic spring means it is noticed during the month of September to November. Hence, it is called as an Antarctic spring. So, in the year 1970, so they found that the thickness of the ozone was decreased to 100 to 150 dpsu unit. Because that one is called as a ozone hole. And it happened in the month of September to November. It is called as an Antarctic spring. If it is happening, what is the disadvantage? What will happen to the life of the Earth? So let us see here. So it is not only affecting the human beings, it is affecting the plant life as well as other animal life. Here, with the depletion of the ozone layer, more UV radiation filters into the troposphere, and it leads to the aging of the skin, cataracts, sunburn, skin cancer, killing of many phytoplanktons, damage the fish conductivity, etc. The plant protein gets easily affected, which leads to the harmful mutations of cells. Increasing in UV radiation damage the paint fibers, causing them to fade faster. So not only the life, that is living beings, plant life, animal life, even it is affecting the buildings. That means the colors are getting faded very faster. So these are the problems of a dangerous UVA, UVB radiation if it is reaching. When these UVA radiations are reaching the Earth, if the thinning of the ozone is happening. So to overcome this, so all the countries of the world came forward, and they took a decision to reduce the usage of these type of compounds in the year 1987, that is called as a Montreal Protocol. So in the year 1987, so after the studies, because of the thinning of this ozone layer, so many problems are found worldwide. That's why all nations of the world came forward under one platform, that is the United Nations Organization, and they took a commitment. They signed a treaty and they took a commitment to stop or replace the CFCs by the alternatives, so that there will be enhancement in the thickness of the ozone in the stratosphere. The life of the earth can be protected. This took place in the year 1987. Just extra information, students. Yeah. What are the problems? According to the syllabus, we have to study the depletion, then the problems of ozone depletion. If the ozone depletion is taking place, so the problems are, it is acting as an irritant. So effects on eye, photokeratitis, cataract, blindness, all are caused due to the UV radiation. Photokeratitis means when these dangerous UVA, UVB is falling on our eye, so we feel like rubbing our eye, irritation in the eye, cataract, blindness, all these because of exposure to these dangerous UV radiation. And what is the effect on the skin? Long exposure to these UV radiation will lead to two type of skin diseases. One is called as melanoma, other one is called as non-melanoma. So there are two types of skin diseases. Melanoma, it is more fatal but very rare, and non-melanoma is less fatal and it is more common. So these are the two types of skin diseases, and it's a sort of skin cancer, we can say. So then it also affects the immune system of the human, that is immune response of skin. See, exposure to UV radiation can also result in suppression of immune response to skin cancer and causes infectious diseases. So not only this, it also damages the DNA and causes the lung cancer. So this UVB radiations can cause DNA damage, because UV radiations can disturb the biomolecules. That means it can alter the structure of a biomolecule. When the biomolecule like protein, nucleic acids are exposed to UV, there will be a structural variation takes place. What is the meaning? So these lipids, proteins, nucleic acids, they'll have a double bond, carbon-carbon double bond, carbon-nitrogen double bond, something like that. So there will be flip, in the functional groups. Due to that, whole molecular structure gets disturbed, the functioning also get disturbed. So that is how the UVB radiations are damaging the DNA. We all know that DNA is nothing but a protein. Again, the protein, it is a number of amino acids joined together. So when it is exposed to the UVB radiation, so if there is a double bonded compound, the functional groups get flipped. It comes under the stereochemistry. That means configuration attainment will take place. Simply I can say the molecular structure gets disturbed when it is exposed to the UVB radiations. And also exposure to the UV radiation by the lungs, it will cause the bronchitis and lung cancer, asthma, etc. These are the problems of the UV radiations if it is filtering into the earth surface. When it gets filtered, only when the thickness of the ozone is decreasing in the stratosphere. So how the ozone is getting decreased in the stratosphere? It is because of the CFCs and HCFCs, hydrochlorocarbons and chlorofluorohydrocarbons. Because of this, all these problems are occurring. How can you avoid? So we don't want all these things to happen. We have to prevent. So how can we prevent? So use of HCF410A in place of HCFC22 for air conditioning and refrigeration. We understood the sources. CFCs are mainly used in air conditioning system and refrigeration system. So earlier HCFC was used, hydrochlorofluorocarbon 22 was used. Now this is replaced by HCF, that means hydrochlorofluoro, there is no chlorine. hydrofluorocarbons. There is no chlorine here. 410A. See, this chloride free radical and bromide free radicals only are dangerous, not the fluorine. So this compound is replaced by this compound. So that recollect the depletion. One chloride radical is there, means it can deplete or degrade 1 lakh molecules of ozone. So to avoid that, replacement of this compound by this compound. That is one example. The second one is use of unleaded gasoline in a vehicles. So why unleaded gasoline? Means leaded gasoline contains the dichloro or the dibromoethane. So after the complete combustion, it can also release the bromide free radical or chloride free radical that can enter into the stratosphere. It will lead to the depletion of the ozone molecules in the stratosphere. Hence, that should be replaced by the unleaded petrol. Instead of leaded petrol, use of unleaded petrol. Right now, we are not using the leaded. It is completely banned due to several issues, environmental issues. It is unleaded gasoline only. Coming to the third one, use of catalytic converter in vehicles. During the combustion of the fuels in our vehicles, like IC engine, internal combustion engine or compression ignition engine, so if there are heteroatoms like chlorine and bromine in them, that also will release this chloride free radical and bromide free radical. So instead of letting them as a chloride radical and bromine radical, so the catalytic converter will convert them into the friendly, eco-friendly substances. A molecular substances means it will not harm the ozone in the stratosphere. So coming to the very, very important one, that is enforcement of Montreal Protocol. Enforcement of the Montreal Protocol means this was took place in the year 1987. As I said, for the first time in the year 1970, the ozone hole was found. So to overcome this problem, all the countries of the world came forward under one platform that is called as Montreal Protocol. They all took a cover. They all signed a treaty. 167 countries signed a treaty. They took a oath to minimize the usage of these type of compounds. That is called as Montreal Protocol. So whatever instructions or decisions are taken by this one, all countries strictly, mandatorily, they have to follow so that we can safeguard. By doing so, from 2011 onwards, so the thickness of the ozone is found to be increased. So with this process, the thickness of the ozone was increased. So the recent Montreal meeting was held in the month of 2019, in the year 2019, between 4th and 8th of the November, and this is called as 31st meet. So members of party 31, all 167 countries, so gather together to discuss about the climatic changes and global warming, all such issues under this platform. So that's called as enforcement of the Montreal Protocol. So I'll stop now. We'll move on to the subtopic in next class.